Everyone you meet, if you get to spend more than an hour with them, if you know, you might not think they're very interesting people, you get stuck with them, you will discover that everybody is complicated. Everyone, without exception. The story came to us via a tiny little article in the newspaper that told the story of a guy called Max Bell, who drove his cab to Darwin to kill himself. We were interested in the idea of someone who'd lived in a small town all of their life, who drove a cab, who at the end of their life decides to go on this massive adventure. When it came time to making the movie, really, I realised that for me, the interesting story was the story of a lonely man who opens up to a full life, and that it's, you know, the idea that perhaps it's never too late to discover all the complexities of life and love. I always thought it would be entertaining to watch someone trying to be as unconnected to the world as they can be, because we as human beings watch it and go, are you fucking kidding? You love her. You love those guys. You find them amusing and charming and funny, and if one of them got injured tomorrow, you'd be the first one there weeping over them.
Rex hides. Rex doesn't own up to a lot of the things that are going on in his life. And he thinks it's a great secret, but in actual fact, everybody knows. I mean, Broken Hill's a small town.
All right, here we go, once more.
It has three or four strong themes through it. You know, one of them is about belonging, you know, and about belonging in Australia, and who belongs here and who doesn't. Which is, you know, we're very lucky to have an extraordinary Aboriginal cast doing this material, but it's an issue that Reg and I have been interested in forever. And there are issues of, you know, another aspect of belonging is when it's time to be here on Earth and when it's time to depart. And that too is explored through the issue of euthanasia.
And I think Darwin is a great place to set those kind of emotional catharsis moments, because it's such a wild, anarchic, loose place that can be the beginning of so much, but also the end of so much. It has that energy about it. When Julie says goodbye, when Tilly says goodbye, it's so Rex can go to the place he's meant to be in. The first research trip that Jeremy Sims and I took, one of the most memorable nights we had was in Oondada, a raucous night in the local pub, the only pub. And a lot of that stuff that was from that particular night, where I stayed up very late with the locals and drank till the dawn, has ended up in the script word for word.
You bought them for me?
No, I bought them for your woman.
She's not my woman. She's my wife. She looked like my woman.
I've been attached to Last Cab to Darwin since it was first conceived as a play by Jeremy Sims and the writer Reg Cribb. I think way back 12 years ago, probably. And I was at the very first table read playing 16 female characters. I think the table read took about 7 hours. Now, that may be an exaggeration. The whole idea of Last Cab to Darwin has been coursing through my veins for more than a decade. So to be in the actual film was a joy.
You know, early on, everyone said, well, obviously you're just going to shoot this around Sydney somewhere and you can make everywhere double for these places and you'll just pretend this and that. And I said, call me crazy, but I just don't think the film will work at all if we don't actually do the trip.
An epic journey, really. You know, 3,000 Ks on the road, shooting as you go, over the Oondada track. seeing places that you heard about and never expected to see. It was quite an adventure.
Now here we are, day one, on the road. I checked the weather forecast and the condition of the Udadada track every day, and I can give you an update. Today, no rain, just this is going to flood past us, and the track is open. And hopefully, this rain will not come anywhere near us, it will stay in the far distance, and the Udadada track will be open. Because if it's not, we're stuffed.
Tell you about how much I hate these fucking flies!
There's so much dust.
Yeah.
But like you said, the rays are high.
Yeah.
Cow's heads.
Yeah.
Look, in a long list of stupid ideas that I've had for how to go about being a successful Australian storyteller, you know, I really have chosen the most difficult path possible.
It's got a very small head though, that's all, isn't it?
I was in England, I was doing Shakespeare at the time, and I was in sort of that world, and sort of a medieval world, and this script arrived out of nowhere, and it was unbelievable. And I remember I cried a lot when I read it the first time, and I knew I wanted to be a part of it.
Excellent. For everything.
Have fun, Ningali.
So it was very nice to know that somebody actually wrote something for you. It's flattering when anyone does write anything specifically for you.
You keep that mangy bloody dog of yours on your side of the street. Yesterday I come out and that big bloody Alsatian from next door was chock-a-block up him.
Would have been a sight.
Looked like it was trying to shake a possum off a pole.
Tell you what, Rex. Drop me off?
Up the road, Udadada.
Okay. Every single Aboriginal community has a tilly in it. Every community has kind of a natural, you know, for want of a better word, you know, a magic man, a storyteller, a charlatan, a trickster in that group. And it's a trope that Aboriginal communities or families encourage one person to have the right to be able to get away with murder.
I want a cigarette. You got one? Useless prick.
It's tricky to say who my favourite character is, but it's possibly Tilly because he's because of what he represents in the big picture of this story. I love what he brings to Rex's life. I love what he says about this country. I love his journey, and I love the line he treads between hope and tragedy. And he's the kind of Indigenous character I want to see on the screen.
I mean, Reg wrote most of his dialogue, and Reg has a really great affinity with Aboriginal people and has been around Aboriginal communities since he was a kid, you know, in country Western Australia.
I want him to be sexy and funny and people to respond to him in all the ways that we respond to the great heroes in classic cinema. And I want us to hurt for him.
Guys, listen up. Your auntie is going to suddenly see what you're doing. You're not thinking about her, don't see her until you hear.
Get this!
There are lots of people like Polly, full-blood Aboriginal woman, you know, living in a nice house with a nice job with the council. And the one thing she doesn't want is have to deal with a fucking family, because it's chaos and she doesn't want it. And so for Polly, her journey is to discover that she does want that chaos. She does want all the things that family brings. And that's a white and black issue. You know, and we thought, well, it's, you know, every time you see a black person there, you know, it's about going to jail or being drunk, or it's all of these black issues. But what if we had a principal character who was black, whose major issue was she wanted to live in a neat house, a neat, tidy house, and go to work and earn a living? That's all she wants to do. I've always been interested in Aboriginal culture anyway, but I'm always really wary of not being a Aboriginal apparatchik. You know, I don't want to just turn up at all those things and say the right stuff and or presume that I have any understanding whatsoever of the depth of shame and guilt and pain and hurt involved in being dispossessed and all the results of that. So I'm not at it from that point of view. But for instance, Ningali years ago took us out bush, a friend of mine, Andy Mack, and I, and pointed out to us that Aboriginal people look at the gaps between the stars, not the stars. You know, that simple understanding that they were looking at the different black bits and the depth of black, which you don't notice at all until it's pointed out, and then suddenly the stars disappear and all you see is the blackness. That's a good allegory to me of what happens when you spend time with Aboriginal people. You start to see the issue for what it is, and it's none of the things that you thought were crucial are crucial, and so many of the things that you thought were minor are major. Pussy Willow used to really exist, and that was in this little white enclave in the middle of Aboriginal traditional lands, and that riff on the postcards is true on that idea of Rex out of Broken Hill looking at things that don't belong here, cats, with an Aboriginal guy about to get in his cab with him. It works on lots and lots of levels.
Why do they string them up?
Because they don't belong here. We'd be fucked without that tree. It's the only reason people come here.
The character I play is called Dr. Nicole Farmer. She's a middle-class doctor with a strong sense of social justice who has settled in Darwin, and she is a passionate advocate for euthanasia. She's seen a lot of her patients suffer. She's a very compassionate woman. She happens to be living in Darwin when the law is passed to legalise euthanasia. Well, she's quite obsessive about the subject, and she wants to take advantage of this and help some people to end their suffering voluntarily. And she encounters the character of Rex, who's terminally ill and who is intent on using the euthanasia laws.
You made it sound like it was a dead set fucking certainty.
It's not easy, Rex. The federal government, the church, the AMA, they don't want this. It takes power away from them and gives it to ordinary people like you and me.
So she and Julie have a problem, because I think Julie thinks that Dr. Farmer is using Rex in some ways as a means to an end to establish this thing, and that she doesn't really know Rex. And Jacki really brought all of that to life. And at one stage, Rex says, "Why do I get the feeling this woman wants me dead?"
They're absolutely as diametrically opposed carers for Rex. One who cares about the bigger picture of what Rex says he wants, and one who just cares about Rex. And it's symptomatic of what all good movies should be about. There's your character's want, and there's your character's need. You know, Rex wants to kill himself in Darwin. Rex needs to go back to Broken Hill and tell Polly he loves her. They're two diametrically opposed things, and that's the engine of the drama.
We were very lucky in many ways that this film was able to be shot almost in sequence, because it was shot on location, on the road.
The big moment of change is always the introduction of a new character. And I think that's what happens when I come in, is there's this big shift in the film and the story and for Rex. And so then I'm there, and then there were two, and then we drive along, and then we come across Emma Hamilton.
When I joined the film, I was physically joining them at Daly Waters.
Gentlemen, cheer up.
Well, I want to play football, and he wants to kill himself.
Two beers, then.
They already had quite a tight bond. They had their own dynamic. They had their own relationship. They'd been having their own adventures. And then they meet me.
Hey! There's one local ingredient you haven't thrown in yet. A nice burnt pencil yam like me.
Look, I just want to welcome everyone here to Daly Waters tonight. It's a special evening for us. We are doing a crucial scene from our film, Last Cab to Darwin. The scene that takes place here tonight involves Dave, who I saw 10 years ago, and he made me laugh then, he still makes me laugh now. One of the beautiful things about Chile's sense of humour is that it's all about an inclusive Australia. It's about an Australia for everybody. And with his sense of humour, he lets everybody know that vision really beautifully. And I thought he did it so well that we included him in our film, which is the story of Rex, a cab driver, who's driving to Darwin to make use of the recently passed euthanasia laws up there. But he's here with his mate, Tilly, who's from Udnadatta, down on the Udnadatta track, and they're heading up north. When they get here, they're surprised to see an army of middle-aged, beautiful, funny, intelligent, well-educated and charming people like yourselves.
My biggest fear was that I hadn't spent enough time with death in my life to make a film about a dying man, and I was really concerned that how I was going to tell that story honestly and organically without that personal experience. And about the same time, a very close friend of mine, unfortunately, a guy called Jerome Ellers, got sick with cancer. And so his story, in the most bizarre way, and I don't know how else to describe it, mirrored the journey of the film. So it was important to me, is the short answer, to have some real first-hand understanding of the idea of what it means to know you're dying, and then to the pragmatic side of, well, how do you do it? And you know, all I can say is that through the most difficult of circumstances, I was allowed, the universe allowed me to have that connection while I was doing it. And you know, the film, if you see it, says "For Jerome" at the end of it. And that's why. I just put my hand up first and say I'm the world's biggest Ed Cooper fan. So he was always first choice to do it. I wanted to have a sense of a single voice articulating Rex's journey. So there's a sense that Ed is in the story with us, and he is Rex's soul. So he plays his guitar with Rex and for Rex, but not separate from Rex. And that's why I wanted to have a single composer, and I wanted to have a single instrument as the dominant instrument. Ooh. we worked a little differently to the way films normally work, in that I got him to record music for the film before we shot it. I got him to come down to the studio and we spent 3 days just recording his impressions of the script. And we then put all those tracks together and took them with us on the trip, and we gave them to everyone. I mean, we travelled 3,000 kilometres with 18 vehicles, 35 people on the crew, and everybody had a CD in their van as we drove and listened to Ed Cooper's driving music as we went.
See, I'm no stranger to the Australian Outback, and my family comes from central Queensland. But this country, central Australia, is just, there's nothing like it. There's just times where there's just nothing. And then all of a sudden you're beside Lake Eyre, and it just goes on forever.
Well, I mean, part of the idea of driving through the desert is that it's a tortured landscape. There was a variety of landscape there that wasn't just all arid. So that did make for a big change, which was a really good thing. And some places we went to were like the moon. This really is extraordinary out there, you know. Fantastic, beautiful, you know.
Steve Arnold, our DOP, has done us proud in terms of how he's captured that. It is. It becomes another character.
You know, some takes were like hundreds of kilometres. I remember, you know, us being curled up in the car shooting, you know, with two cameras inside the car and people crammed in at all various odds and ends, you know, for 150 or 200 kilometres. You know, that was a common thing.
We made it up the Udadada track, and we got here safely without too much damage, too much loss. I think we had 10 or 12 tyres blown, replaced, one rim shot to pieces, two windscreens, one higher windscreen, one other windscreen, a Welsh plug out of the taxi, whatever that is, and no damage. I think only one person got a cut finger, no harm done otherwise. So relatively unscathed, I say, and very happy we're on time and on schedule and almost on budget.
I mean, the central story of my film is their love story. That's the central story of Last Cab to Darwin, and it's a black woman and a white guy.
They've never really sat down and worked all of that out, really. You know, they've never really said that I really love you. And Rex really denies all of that to himself on his journey to Darwin. He won't acknowledge it.
He is gentle with her. He is respectful of her. He is loving towards her. But he isn't brave enough to tell the world that. That's his dilemma. Rex is the sort of guy that would say, oh, Jesus, don't carry on like a pork chop. You know, don't voice your opinion. Don't be too passionate. Don't be engaged. And it's something that's always given me the shits. And I think Reg is the same. So we wanted to write a character, an Australian character, who discovers that life is much more enjoyable and full when you do stick your head above the parapet and have an opinion.
He's the sort of character that keeps his cards close to his chest, and he just becomes involved with people unlike his life in Broken Hill, which is a bit of a lie, really. So he's sort of, in deciding to end his life, he finds this other life.
Because everybody in the film is changed by Rex. Everybody is a better person for having met and dealt with Rex's story. It's a coming-of-age movie for a 70-year-old man.
Jeremy Sims hereafter will be referred to as God.
If not for you, the sun would be shining down.
Don't think I'm going to stop being angry at you just because you put Libby on.